our vending machines, because that's my priority was when I walked into, you know, we're trying to promote healthy, and we've got sweets and crisps and fizzy drinks on offer all the time, so we're going to change them all to juice bars. Got my guarantee on that one.
Can I say one other thing as well? I'm an amateur nutritionist, right?
Yeah.
But basically, and I have the qualifications. But we must also be aware that juice, right, is the way that we
No, not that sort of juice bar.
Oh, sorry.
Is it? It's like, you know, your smoothies with your fruit, and it's all that. It's all done that way. It's all healthy.
Okay, let's
yeah.
take, but please be aware, right, that the nutrition is expressive.
Yeah, it's better than crisps and sweets and
kosher.
That's sugar.
So I confirm smoothies and juice can be also got very, very high
sugar
in there,
yeah.
Thank you. I mean, at this event in high school, we're looking at preparing materials on life skills, part of which is parenting. And one of the young ones there said that I thought it was devastating. And she knew the importance of not feeding her child these sweet drinks. Yeah, when she gets, it's a really good water diet as far as drink goes. When she goes out, because she doesn't want to be, she doesn't want her child to be thought of as poor, she actually does lots of other ones, so it just gives them these fruit juices.
Mm-hmm.
With all the dangers which you just hinted at. So, mucking up those, isn't it?
Just the other thing to add on to that from today, it was a really, really interesting event as you say. What we're going to develop now is constituency plans in relation to the food issues, so to say. So if you're interested in getting involved, that would be really good, because we're looking at localised plans and how we can do that to target what's best for Birkenhead. So we're really keen to talk to you about that.
Any other questions, please?
Can I just ask, related to that, is water readily available? Just water?
Yes.
In all the centres?
Free.
Yeah.
Is it free?
Pieces of
These aren't new skills, do you? But we're actually asking for them. This is to help. Molly?
It's like if all members of the public have finished asking questions, then we are to ask a question. I'm going to say the officers, but thank you very much. I hope it's not a hard one. There was a meeting the other week about on care issues, and during the course of the meeting, I was talking to Graham Hodgkins, not Graham Hodgkins, I was talking to us about services, sort of low level support services that probably wouldn't be delivered to people with meeting the eligibility criteria, but which are very important. And one of the services that we were talking about that need reviewing is lunch and clubs. And I said, wouldn't it be a good idea if we had a local management of lunch and clubs review them locally, review the provision, see that it actually matched the need, and it could be done to the constituency committees. And Graham said, well, there is a plan for devolving different services down, and it's 2 years before we get to lunch and clubs. Now, I'm interested to know there's a plan that I haven't seen, but that might be because I haven't seen it. It doesn't mean it doesn't exist. But is there a plan, and what kind of services can we see it? Can we know what our future is? Or is it a secret until we get in there?
There's been a lot of change in adults and adult services, and they've really got hold of, as Joe mentioned, around the commissioning. I met with them last week to talk through what the changes are and what services there are. And after only putting 2 hours on the car, I said I need to come back. So we've actually booked a half-day session in just after Easter to talk through what the provision is and fitting it in with the constituency plan and how what they're doing. And lunch and clubs has brought up this, we were talking about 6 months, not 2 years.
It's not so much that, Dawn, it's the fact that there is a sort of schedule for bringing in different services that it may be that I haven't seen it and everybody else is aware of it, but is there a plan? And if so, can we look at it and see what our future is?
I'm not aware of that, but I can ask at the meeting, I'll circulate any information.
So that we actually develop this agenda and make it even more interesting, I think, for the citizens that actually turn up. George and I went to visit the Cavendish Centre recently, and a real sort of day centre service, and had lost, for whatever the reasons are, in the contracting. Now, I wrote as well as George did about who won the contract and what did the winning contract actually provide. I'm still actually waiting for an answer. There's been some very good work which Anna's done in making sure that Cavendish has got a lifeline of funds to continue. And I said, Morris, but I still don't know what the actual contract is. That's the second point then, is to what extent, which I think was Morris' point, is that those sorts of contracts going to be devolved down?
Well, is there a plan or thought? Not just in social services that I have to be more interested in that than some other things, but across the way, is there a plan that was in existence about the time scale for rolling out different services for developing them? Because that was the impression I got, to be honest, from the conversation with Ryan.
I don't think there is a plan structured. The two services that's been looked at first is antisocial behaviour and street scene. That's more based on the basis of having a constituency hub of services, but I'm due to move into that constituency hub next month, and there will only be two of us, myself and the engagement officer. So I can follow it up and look at, because I think now the constituency committees are more established, what that time scale is. There's nothing there right at the moment.
I think it may be a question that needs to go to the director,
I thought we should actually, that could be minuted as a question to the Chief Executive to tell us. Is that right? Any other questions? Alan?
Just picking up the point about, Joe talks about the extensive piece of work that you're doing in relation to commissioning, and then working with other public sector bodies to look for opportunities going forward. I don't think that should deflect us as Birkenhead Constituency Committee from getting on from what is an important piece of work to look at the amount of money that clearly has been spent in the constituency, which is quite, as we see, is quite considerable. And I think there is a job related to some sort of task and finish activity that this committee should undertake, looking specifically, because once we've got the figures, that's not by far, nowhere near is it the end of it, because you've then got to look in some detail at exactly what you're achieving for that level of money. And we can't just sit here and wait while others get on and do things and it gets devolved down. I think we have to grasp the opportunity and get on with it ourselves.
I agree with that. Yeah. That exercise you described is, when we've got those figures, it's the end of the beginning. It's not actually, it opens up the whole process, which we're trying to do. Denise?
I'm more of a somber matter, Chair. I'm just wondering, do we know how many pensioners died with the increase in, obviously, heating bills and food costs, how many pensioners we lost in Birkenhead over the winter period? Because I did speak about this before.
Can we minute that to our public health? Could they actually look at the latest data that they have of how this year's figures compare with actually last year's figures that we give all that so we can check an answer? Maureen?
When you're doing your action plan for the Birkenhead Tramway area, particularly in the area where the Woodland School is, there's a very high incidence of hate crime. There needs to be a lot of work done within those communities there, because there is a lot of hate, not only with race, but with disability and, you know, transgender. So it is, you know, quite a high incidence in that area. And if you want that area to be a safe place to be, I think you have to look at that as part of your action.
Just to say, myself, Jean, Brian, as the board councillor there, have got a meeting with all those residents in a week or so's time to discuss just that issue.
Very good. I want to make a plea to search it through you. We've had a whole series of questions which have been promised answers to, which I've not noted down. I would like to have the draft minutes on Monday to refresh my mind on what the points are, so that we can actually then start to have issue minutes which are accurate. They've only got to be done once. And it's actually very important, I think, for the chairman, have the draft minutes quick to approve. I don't think we've made that mistake we made in the last minutes, if we'd have had it within days rather than weeks or months. Please.
Just a quick comment, following on about Cavendish. I attended a number of meetings to do with Cavendish Centre, and quite clearly there was a lot of distress caused by the way the commissioning took place. I don't believe that they blew their own trumpet enough, and I don't believe the council really appreciated what has been done in that centre over a period of many years, and people have been really dedicated to the service they provide. And they've been running this on a shoestring compared to a lot of other luncheon club providers, so I'm led to believe. And I just hope that lessons have been learned for the future to prevent such stress being created to amongst a group of very worthwhile volunteers, and also the people who are serving in this area. You know, people were really, really upset about it and just didn't know how to turn the situation around. So I do hope that lessons have been learned from that experience.
I think that's a, you know, very valid comments, Pat. I mean, I think there were issues around that commissioning process, really, that, you know, haven't served the Cavendish well. Since that time, myself and Harrison have met with the management committee there, have been working with officers, and are now looking at how we can help them going forward. Because, as you say, they provide a very valuable service to vulnerable sections of the community in the deprived area. And done a, you know, do a marketing job there. So we are working very closely with them at the moment to see what we can do to help them going forward. And the service does continue.
Yes, I understand. So, okay.
Yeah. Well, George and I just dropped in to see, so we know it actually operates well. And also, the questions which we posed after it was, if we're not supporting a service like this, where are we buying a better service? We have not been able to get an answer to that. We almost treat it as though it was an improper question to ask. Whereas, Lynn's point is a dead central question to ask about contract replacement. So, that break the water link to ask another question.
Medical planning, doctrine of medical planning to save labels. But looking at comparing world local plan, draft local plan, there's checkers and testers, draft local plan. There's a world of difference.
Say something, this is at the end of our meeting, which will raise spirits. I've got Devonshire Park has done. What the objectives are, but also the difficulties you've actually had. Let's be honest about this as well.
Well, with Frank's help, we were actually one of the 17 Bangor communities to really be the pilot communities for advancing neighbourhood plans under the government's localism act. Unfortunately, we were, as well as very pleased with that, and it being a fantastic opportunity for us. It was also, we were victims of our own success in some respects, because as we were moving along with our neighbourhood plan, the regulations were kind of continually changing as the government was getting greater and greater clarity of what it wanted to achieve with neighbourhood planning. And we actually started our neighbourhood planning process a few years before it became a vision of David Cameron's eye. And it was in response to unwelcome developments in our area. Devonshire Park is an area with a number of large Victorian character properties, and they were being continually targeted by developments for converting them into flats and bed sits and supported housing, institutional housing, of a commercial nature, and not always a very welcome nature of the community. We already have quite a lot of that kind of property, both flats, we have way over the national and local average, and also a number of supportive living and housing programmes in the area for what is really a very small community. So we wanted to try and take control of that and try and protect our family housing as part of the mix so that we can continue to have a safe and peaceful family and a sustainable area. Really, in terms of the reality of neighbourhood planning, part of it has been a tremendously positive experience of the community really coming together and being able to crystallise how we would like Devonshire Park to be in 5 years, 10 years' time, the values really that we hold as a community, and what's important to us in terms of the way the community looks and feels, particularly the balance of housing stock in the area. In terms of the reality of kind of bringing this plan through the local authority process and within the framework of the national planning agenda, it's been a real nightmare. And if you're going to embark on that, you know, really it's going to be a real test of your mettle to jump through the various hoops, and in our case, the ever-changing hoops and hurdles that have really been needed.
I think it's a problem if you're proposing to do something that is clearly against the neighbourhood planning regulations.
Yes,
what you're allowed to do.
But I suppose to kind of finish that off and not leave it on the negative, you know, Devonshire Park now have been at least the test community for Wirral Council, and I think it's been a really good learning experience for Wirral Council. The council has particularly been tremendously supportive, and I think the planning officers also are really starting to get with the programme now and start to work with us in a more in a closer partnership to make sure that we can get this thing through the final stages and take it to a referendum hopefully this year, maybe
aspiration, and a lot of, you know, energy and difficult energy has gone into it, but still feeling that really we're at the beginning of something that is tremendously positive. You know, could have a tremendous impact on the ability of Liverpool people to have a voice in their local area. You know, hearing the things that have been said about Rock Park and, you know, the other really important things that are happening around the area. And I would, you know, really encourage people to get involved. You know, if you've got the time and the information and the tenacity to do it, then do get involved.
Lynn is too polite to tell you that we were the first approved pilot. We're now number 18. Less